Yo, MVP, let's go.
All of my life, I've never known you to fail. You remain the same and wonderful is your name. All of my life, I've never known you to fail. You remain the same and wonderful is your name.
Good morning, everyone. Would you guys stand with us? Hey, we're so happy that you guys are here today. There's a lot to celebrate today. I want to say happy Father's Day to all the fathers in the room.
And happy Juneteenth.
Yes. Yes. Yeah, we're so happy you guys are here to worship with us today. Here at DCC, we like to do a little call to worship. It's a little bit of a call and response. It's very simple. There's going to be some words on the screen. So I'm going to say, I was glad when they said to me, and then you guys are going to repeat or say what's on the screen. So super easy. We do this regularly, but every now and then it's a good reminder about how this works. So yeah, we're so happy that you're here. So I was glad when they said to me,
"Let us go into the house of the Lord."
Awesome. Would you sing with us in worship this morning?
believe it.
Surrender ourselves to you and just say, have it all, God. You know where we are this morning. You know where our hearts are. And we need you. So this is a time that we collectively come before you and give it back to you. Giving me life with it. You traded beauty for ashes. You gave it all for me. Love greater than my sin. Reached out and rescued me. You gave me beauty for ashes. And all you've done and all you gave, you did it just for me.
Did it just for me.
And all I have and all I am, I give it back to thee. Have it all. Have it all. Have it all. Take away all my shame, to rid me of all my past, just to be one with you. You traded beauty for ashes. I don't deserve your love, but you picked me up anyway. You've seated me in your place. Traded beauty for ashes, and all you've done, and all you gave, you did it just for me.
Did it just for me.
And all I have, and all I am, I give it back to thee. Lord, have it all. Have it all. Have it all.
Kids, for praising with us. Now it's time for you to find your teachers in the back and head to your classes. As they're journeying back there, come on and sing with us. We love our kids and you.
Amen. Praise God. Y'all take a seat. Well, got my man Mike up here today. We are going to honor dads today. In the garden at the very beginning, and we learned this in our men's retreat, God made men and women to be keepers of the garden. That means they are designed by God, bearing the image of God with dignity and a responsibility to bring flourishing to the people around them, whether that's where they work or the people they care for, the responsibilities. And so each of us are made to do that. And dads have a unique opportunity to have certain influence over the people in their lives. And so we want to recognize that today. And at the same time, some of us in here wince when we consider our dads. Some of us have real pain and trauma that comes with a history of dad and what he was for you or wasn't for you. And we do recognize and think on you today and encourage and are praying that that you would be confronted by the love of your Father in heaven, whose love you can swim in, even though you were lacking that in your life. And at the same time, among us are men who are faithfully serving, who are faithfully trying. Faithfully doesn't mean perfect. Faithfully means keeping on going, being loyal, a certain loyal love for the people around them. And we want to recognize and honor them today, too, as well as the men in our lives that desire to be dads, who have struggled with infertility, or who have it's taking longer than expected, and it's a painful journey. I want to honor you as well today and remember you today in prayer. And so if you're a dad or you're wanting to be a dad, today in the back, before you leave today, straight from the Eagle for Garden, which is across the street from my house, which is perfect, Claire Howell and her team have assembled some seasoning that you can use for grilling, that you can use for cooking with. It smells perfect. And it's straight from the garden. It's delicious. It's free. Get you some. So if you're a dad or you're striving to be a dad in your marriage and you're hoping to one day have a child, we want to honor you as well. So grab that, please, on the way out. I'm going to have Micah pray for us, and then we'll take communion.
Awesome. May guys, just stretch out your hands towards any fathers, expecting fathers, future dads. Just go ahead and join us in that. Man, Father, first and foremost, we thank you, Father, that you are the ultimate dad. God, that you are the ultimate sacrificial example of union in a relationship, Father God, of leadership, of righteousness, Father God. And we thank you that no matter our wounds, no matter our burdens, no matter our hurts, no matter our pains, Father God, you give us a perfect example in your word of what it looks like to be a father, Father God. And you know that you show us fatherhood starts with sonship. Fatherhood starts with submission to you, God. So I thank you, Father, as I'm surrounded by so many great men, Father God, that are submitting their lives to you, Father God, that are sacrificing their lives to you, Father, that they would take that submission and bring it into their first ministry that is their home, Father God, that they would live a life of sacrificial love, Father God, discipline, strength, role modeling, Father God, what it looks like to love, Father God, and to be present, Father God, in their homes, Father. We pray for men who have broken wounds, Father God, scars, hurts, and pains from absentee earthly fathers, God, and we pray that they would latch on to the kingdom, that they would latch on to who you are as a father, and that those scars will become wounds, Father God. Those wounds will become scars, Father God, that they can talk about, that they can use those testimonies to reach out to other men who need you and who need the gospel, Father God. I pray for our brothers in Christ who are designed to be fathers, Father, that you would give them the ability, Father God, that you would be the miracle worker and the way worker, Father God, for them to produce, Father God. And if not in that season, Father God, I pray you would give them the heart of adoption as you have adopted us, Father God, to bring in and reconcile those who have not a father, those who have not been connected to an earthly father, God, that they would be that spiritual and physical representation of a dad, Father God, that they would show that love, they should show that correction and that commitment, Father God, to those young ones, Father. We thank you for today. We thank you for who you are as a father, and we thank you for the fathers that are present now and the fathers that will be. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you, Micah. If you don't have the communion elements yet, you can go to the back and get those off the table. We're going to take communion today, remembering the Lord and his death. Give everyone a chance to go grab that. What's unique about communion, about the Lord's Supper, is that it gives us this opportunity to join in with Christians from around the globe who have historically been doing this since the days of Jesus. In a society where we sometimes are challenged for what we believe or we wonder about what we believe, there is this singular thread that goes all the way back to the first century, where they were taking of the elements and remembering our Lord Jesus through the elements, through both the bread and the wine or the juice. And so today we're going to take of that. I want to give you a second to bow your head and close your eyes. Communion is not a sad thing. It is a serious thing to be celebrating. And so I just want to give you a second. Paul talks about this idea of taking it with a sense of worthiness. And so I just want to give you a second. If there's anything that you want to just pray on or confess to the Lord or admit to the Lord before you partake and remember his death, remember his resurrection, I want to just give you a minute for that. Father, thank you that you give us your Son, who covers a multitude of sins through the love that he gave. Thank you that his body was crushed for our iniquities, that his blood was poured out that we might be healed in his stripes. Would you please strengthen us as we go, as we remember, as we partake together. In Jesus' name, amen. Reading from Matthew 26, it says, or Matthew 26, verse 26 says this: Now as they were eating, Jesus took bread, and after blessing it, broke it, just like his body would be. And he gave it to the disciples and said, Take and eat, this is my body. Take. And then Jesus took a cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, Drink of it, all of you, for this is the blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins. Drink, please. Amen. In this way, we proclaim the Lord's death until the day that he returns, and we remember what he's done for us together. Praise God.
Would you stand with us as we continue to praise and worship our King?
Storm, 'cause even when the world war's wage I take heart. I know you are greater, forever your Savior. I will sing your praise with all that I have, with all that I am, Lord. With all that I have, with all that I am, Lord. I won't let the storm wet up my heart. Won't let the darkness keep me down. Singing the night, my hope alive in you. I'll walk through the fire and not be burned. Pray in the night and watch it turn. Jesus, tonight I give it all to you. I won't let the storm weather my heart. Won't let the darkness keep me down. Sing in the night, my hope alive in you. I'll walk through the fire and not be burned. Play in the fire and watch it turn. Jesus, tonight I give it all to you. Yeah. I won't let the storm weather my heart. Won't let the darkness keep me down. Sing in the night, my hope alive in you. I'll walk through the fire and not be burned. Pray in the fire and watch it turn. Jesus, tonight I give it all to you. 'Cause even when the world caves, even when the fight calls, even when the wars wage, I'll take heart. You are greater, forever your Savior. I will sing your praise with all that I have, with all that I am, Lord. With all that I have, with all that I am,
God, as we come before you as your children this morning, looking to hear from you, this morning is opportunity, Lord, to hear from on high. So I pray, God, you would prepare our hearts for the word and prepare the heart of the messenger. May he speak with the authority of your word behind him and open our ears to hear, God. We love you. We're grateful for the gathering of your people. We just pray for your word to touch us and move us to mission. In Jesus' name, amen.
Are we going to read the scripture from Job chapter 2? Verses 11 to 13. Now when Job's three friends heard of all this evil that had come upon him, they came each from his own place: Eliphaz the Temanite, Bildad the Shuhite, and Zophar the Nemuthite. They made an appointment together to come to show him sympathy and comfort him. When they saw him from a distance, they did not recognize him, and they raised their voices and wept. And they tore the robes and sprinkled dust up on their heads toward heaven. And they sat with him on the ground 7 days and seven nights. And no one spoke a word to him, for they saw that his suffering was very great.
Chapter 3. After this, Job opened his mouth and cursed the day of his birth. And Job said, "Let the day perish on which I was born, and the night that said, 'A man is conceived.' Let that day be darkness. May God above not seek it, nor light shine upon it. Let gloom and deep darkness claim it. Let clouds dwell upon it. Let the blackness of the day terrify it. That night, let thick darkness seize it. Let it not rejoice among the days of the year. Let it not come into the number of the months. Behold, let that night be barren. Let no joyful cry enter it. Let those curse it who curse the day, who are ready to rouse up Leviathan. Let the stars of its dawn be dark. Let it hope for light, but have none, nor see the eyelids of the morning, because it did not shut the doors of my mother's womb, nor hide trouble from my eyes.
Why did I not die at birth, come forth from the womb and expire? Why did the knees receive me, and why did the breast that I should suck? For now I would have lain down and been quiet. I would have slept in, and I would have been at rest with the kings and the counselors of the earth, who rebuilt ruins for themselves, or with princes who had gold, who were filling their houses with silver, or like a miscarriage, which is discarded. I would not be as an infant that never saw light. There the wicked ceased from raging, and there the weary are at rest. The prisoners are at ease together. They do not hear the voice of the taskmaster. The small and the great are there, and the slave is free from his master. Why is light given to him who suffers, and life to the bitter of soul? Who long for death, but there is none, and dig for more than for hidden treasures? Who rejoice greatly and exult when they find the grave? Why is light given to man whose way is hidden and whom God has helped in? For my groaning comes at the sight of my food, and my cries pour out like water. For what I fear comes upon me, and what I dread befalls me. I am not at ease, nor am I quiet, and I am not at rest, but turmoil comes.
Y'all do me a favor and just give it up for Marcus, his last time to carry the podium. I almost cried. Y'all think I'm playing? I legitimately almost cried. I had to catch myself. Why am I about to cry? Because Marcus is moving. But today is a happy day, right? It's also a sad day. We're going to talk about that. Welcome to Spoiler Alertsville. I am the mayor. My name is Ryan. Today we're going to be talking about Stranger Things Season 4. So if you haven't watched it, there are exits at the rear and sides of the plane. I'm just kidding. I'm not talking about Stranger Things. I'm just kidding. I am, however, going to make mention of one of the greatest influences that the Duffer Brothers had in writing Stranger Things. Does anyone want to take a guess who does not already know, having been communicated with by me? Does anyone want to guess what I'm talking about? What am I going to make mention of? Anyone? Okay, wow, I thought you would know me better than this. I'm going to talk about It this morning. I'm going to talk about It. Now, yes, It is about a scary clown. But Stephen King is a genius, and he writes more about humanity than he does about monsters. The monsters are just mirrors of ordinary people becoming extraordinary in order to overcome an abnormal circumstance. That is his bent. Here's why I bring that up. All right, there's this group of kids who are brought together by a shared experience, if you will. They are all being haunted by this monster. Again, good morning, and you know, it's a happy day. They're being haunted by this monster who appears to them in the form of their greatest fear.
So sometimes it's goofy, right? Like it'll appear as like a spider or a werewolf. But there are other times where he haunts these kids based on some of their hardest life experiences, some things that are most traumatic, or the fear of the transition that they're in, what they've experienced, the abuse that they have suffered. There's all of these things that this monster is utilizing in order to capitalize and maximize their fear. And these kids come together and they talk about this experience that they're having and this kind of understanding of this monster, and they say, well, I saw it like this, and I saw it like this, and I saw it like this, but they're recognizing, oh, this is all the same thing. And they make a choice to face their fear together. They decide to run into what has haunted them as a team. Spoiler alert, they don't beat it. They numb it. They do away with it for a while, but wouldn't you know it, 27 years later, it's back. For those who care about like nuance and just good art, It was a TV series in 1990, and It Chapter One, the movie that came out in 2017. That's 27 years, just chef's kiss. If I just put you on, I'm telling you, all of it is the best. So anyways, it comes back around 27 years later, and these kids, who are no longer kids, have to make a choice. What are they going to do with those hard days from their past? What are they going to do with what haunted them in the past? Are they going to face it? Are they going to team up again? Voltron up? Go make war on their biggest fear? Or are they going to run? Are they going to try to escape? Are they going to try to pretend it just isn't real, stuff it deep down, and try to escape through all of the ways that they could? I bring that up today because of Job. Dang it, Job. Today's tough. Many of us, similarly, are living in some hard days. They are happening to us now. Others of us, maybe those historically hard days are coming back to haunt you in your present. But regardless, whatever it looks like, there is this reality. You know, it's Father's Day, so it might be that you have lost your father. Or dads, it might be that you lost a kid through any sort of horrible circumstances. It's also Juneteenth. We want to talk about history that still haunts us to this day. It's a day of celebration. It's also a day of lament. Whether you're a father or not, whether you're a brother or sister of some sort of black African descent, there are hard days that come back for us, aren't there? You've had times that weren't exactly the best, and here they are again. Some triggering event, a memory, an anniversary, a holiday, and it seems like what happened so long ago is happening right now. It's fresh, back to the surface. And you have to make a choice similar to those kids from Derry. Are you going to face the monster that haunts you? Or are you going to continue trying to run from those historically hard days? The question that I want to answer today is, how do I handle historically hard days? Whether they are happening to me now, similar to what we talked about a couple weeks back, or they're haunting me still. They've come back around again. That's the question that's on the table. Little light sermon today. But my hope is that as we study the book of Job, we'll be back in Job chapter 2, verse 11 is where we start, where we're going to start, and we're actually going to cover about three chapters. I'm not going to read it all, and we're not going to be here all day, I can assure you that. But we're going to cover a lot for a very specific purpose, because I want us to live truth. I want us to be practicing the way of Jesus, even when it's hard, because the alternative is worse. And life just isn't easy. Can I get an amen? If you can't say amen, just say ouch, in the words of Pastor Jerry. There are two goals that I personally have today, and that we have as a team for this series on the whole. I want you to understand Job, but I also want you to experience it. So with today's sermon, I really want to try to do both of those things. And it was kind of hard for me to put together, to be honest, but I think that maybe we'll do it together. So I want you to understand. I want you to understand the structure and the storyline of Job, but I don't want this to feel like a lecture. I don't want it to feel like an information dump. Like, you could have read this in a book. But I do want you to be able to walk away and live in any country and any continent and be a part of any church body, reading from any translation in any language, and be like, I understand the structure of this book a little bit better. But I also today want you to feel and live the truth that is in these pages. That is the hope that I have for us today. And if you'll recall, Job is wisdom literature. Do you remember what the goal of Job is for you? Not everybody all at once. Do you remember the goal? Experience it and apply and live out the W word. Oh, there you go. Wisdom. Say wisdom. Everybody say wisdom. That's right. And so Job, in a nutshell, wisdom trusts God's wisdom all the time, no matter what. And so today, as we kind of move through that question of how do I handle historically hard days that still haunt me, whether they are happening now or they've come back from the past, how do I handle them? And handling historically hard days requires that we insulate, that we get it out, and that we hold on. Insulate, get it out, hold on. First point, insulate, don't isolate. Say insulate, don't isolate. Okay, get used to that. Make sure you're still here. Now, it might feel like forever ago, but in 2021, we all experienced something where we may have learned a little bit about insulating. Who recalls Snowmageddon 2021? Abology, I remember seeing you on screen, right? With the BBC or something like that. So you remember it. Others of you may remember it. That was a time when we learned, you know, how to keep all of our heat in one room. Anybody, that was your experience? Or how to insulate, like, our pipes or other parts of our house with pool noodles? Anybody? Yeah, that was something, wasn't it? And when the cold nights of our past creep back up to haunt us, we need, similarly, community huddling around us. We need our people close by, keeping us warm, keeping us insulated. And that's something that we see here in Job as Job's friends come to mourn with him. You saw that, what Hans read in chapter 2, the very end of chapter 2. We don't know, like Waldo said last week, we don't know how much time has passed. I can tell you, Job's not on the news, okay? He's not trending. He didn't just text his group thread with an obscure update. Anybody get obscure updates from time to time? You know what I'm talking about. Communication wasn't very quick then, and travel wasn't either. So some amount of time has elapsed. It's gone by. And however much that is, what we see is that Job's friends are committed to him. They make it a point to come to where he is. They come to Job. Why? We see it at the end of verse 11. It says that they made an appointment to come to show him sympathy and comfort him, which is a different way of saying to shake the head. which is so graphic, right? They came to shake the head, which I'm assuming is just like you lower your head and you just shake at the sheer suffering that you witness in your friend. It's another way of describing, it's a figure of speech representing grief or mourning. And as they get closer to Job, the Hebrew says that they are looking extremely intently. They're putting in a crazy amount of effort to find him. Like he's off in the distance and they're really working hard. Which says two things. Job's friends have a crazy amount of effort that they're putting into finding Job and being with Job. But it also says how unrecognizable Job was. They couldn't tell that it was Job based on all that he had experienced and gone through. They didn't recognize him. And when they finally see him, when they finally the light comes on, like, oh snap, this is Job. They were so moved that they pivoted. They didn't just like mourn with him, they went full on funeral mode, mourning for Job. As if he had perished, as if he was dead. Because they saw that his suffering, which is a word that depicts both mental and emotional suffering, not just the physical pain that he was going through, that his suffering was more than they'd ever anticipated. So they tore their clothes, covered themselves in dust. That was kind of their picture of what it looked like to be in the afterlife, if you will, this kind of small sliver. And they mourned, what it says is 7 days and seven nights, which could be a literal week. It could also be communicating a completion, right? They sat with Job as long as it took. The complete amount of time of his grieving in community, they just sat with him. They were just with him. Culturally, speaking before Job would have been a faux pas, so they just gave him the gift of presence. They were just with him so that Job wasn't alone. Job wasn't isolated. Job had friends covering him as he suffered. He was insulated. And when historically hard days come to you or when they come back to you, insulate, don't isolate. The question here would be, do you have people who know you? Like, legitimately know you. They know your patterns. They know your triggers. They come alongside you when they can foresee that something is happening. Today's Father's Day. How are you doing today? I see you today. Or it's on the horizon, right? And they don't just know you, but they walk with you. They grieve with you. Or grieve with you all over again and again. And again, and uncomfortable as it is to let others in, I think that we could all agree that it's worth it. I can imagine that if I asked everyone to raise their hands, if when their life was getting its most tumultuous, most turbulent, if you wanted people there holding you down, I can imagine 99.4% of us would raise our hands. 0.6 would maybe be sleeping, right? And hard as it is so worth it to be insulated with community. God is tangibly providing for us in our siblings. Here's the flip side of this point. Do you seek out your friends, your siblings, when they are in their suffering? I think we're familiar with the passage that says, weep with those who weep. We are all in the process of building trust together. It's a labor of love, right? To constantly show up for each other. But when that laboring turns into someone at your door, literally and metaphorically speaking, do you drop everything and make space for them? No matter what's going on. Because that's a need that we have, to be insulated. That is a picture of insulating in a nutshell, that we go the distance for our people, that we be with those we love when they're hurting, and we give them space to grieve. Be insulated, don't be isolated. Speaking of, Job, he speaks up, he grieves with his friends, and we see his response in chapter 3. And if you recall from the reading, it's pretty dark. So let's go there together now. Here's the second point. Get your grief out. Say, get it out. Get your grief out. Grieving takes a while. Anyone familiar with this? Sometimes it comes in waves, or sometimes you have just excused it for a bit. You've put it in the bottom drawer and said, I'm going to come back to this one later. More on that in a second. Our culture recently, in the past, decade or so, has become a culture that celebrates counseling a bit more. And the goal of counseling is to help us to be a people who can handle things that in our society we don't do well. Now, I hope that counseling helps us to do that. But we as a society, for whatever reason, be it kind of the bootstrap mentality, the kind of immigrant dream, right, in theory at least, that we just pull ourselves up by our bootstraps, we get it done, we don't have time to slow down, we overcome, we adapt, we make it happen. Maybe that contributes to this. But we do not produce a society that is good at grieving. We are not a people who just naturally go toward successfully mourning. We run from inconvenience. We avoid discomfort like it's a plague. We're not very good at handling pain. And all of those are almost perfectly encapsulated in losing someone that we love, in bereavement, in the death of someone close to us. Death is like the premier taboo. Death is like the premier taboo in our society. And these things are antithetical to us. We oftentimes struggle to know what to do with them. And because of that, I wonder how much we actually show up honestly to the spaces where we are insulated. Because we are so used to just like powering through that we have a filter that we forget to change. How many of you haven't changed your air filter in a while? It's summertime, baby. Go change that thing quickly. That thing's been running crazy. Similarly, we have a filter that I'm sure needs to be changed out that just catches all of the things of like, you don't need to talk about that. You don't need to share that. You don't even think about it. Subconsciously, it just happens to us. It's a part of who we are. So I wonder how many people actually know the woundedness that we walk with. And Job gives us a prime example of how to get it out. Say, get it out. First half of this chapter, Job is cursing his beginning. That's what's happening. And it is one of, I think, my favorite passages of Scripture, which sounds morbid potentially, but it's because Job is lamenting the day of his birth in such a creative way, which is a pun that I'm going to get back to. So he uses this verbal form. It's adjusive, like 14, 15 of them, so many of them. It's like a third-person imperative, like, yo, nobody deal with this day. This day is the worst. That's all the lets that you see. Let the day perish. Let that day be darkness. Let gloom. Let clouds. Let the blackness. It's just all of these, like, may this be the thing. Verbal wishes. I wish I'd never been born. I wish my birthday was blotted out of the calendar. This was kind of a common thing, actually, in Mesopotamian culture. They actually had calendar days when they would be like, hey, ladies, if you're going into labor, lock it up. This is a bad day to have a baby. It's bad luck. It was common. They had days like this for all type of stuff. Don't get married on this day. It was just a thing that they did. And Job is saying, my birthday needs to be taken off of every calendar that's ever existed. No one celebrate it. No one rejoice. No parties. No nothing. That day needs to be out of there. And the most poetic part about that is that he uses Genesis 1 in juxtaposition to his birthday. You know, the same way God said, let there be light in verse 4, Job says, I think it's verse 4, Job says, and for that day, let there be darkness. In the creation account, everything starts with light and it ends with rest. And here, it starts with darkness and it ends without rest. That is the depth of Job's emotion. That's his turmoil. And he is lamenting. He's getting it out. And the first half is just railing his beginning. And then he questions his existence. He ties this this series of rhetorical questions together. And as a reader, it's building tension. You're like, oh man, Job is shouting, why is this happening to me? Why is this so hard? God, why? Which draws the reader in to look for resolution to his struggle, but also it draws out of us our own questions. Yeah, I've wondered something, Matt, similar to that, Job, but I also wondered this. It's the point of the book. That's why it switches to poetry, because don't songs have a way of taking you somewhere that other things don't have the power to do for you? People in here love music, man. I'm not going to give any Stranger Things references, okay? If you know, you know. Okay, Bush. All right. The rest of what he's saying in this chapter, as simply as I can put it, Job wants to die. That's where he's at. I don't want to be here. I don't want to deal with this. I wish I was dead. He wished his birthday hadn't happened, verse 10, but since it did, he's wondering why he couldn't have been stillborn or why he couldn't have been miscarried in verses 11 and 12 and in verse 16. He wished he could have been spared this suffering, but since he wasn't, he basically says, I'll settle for dying right now. Can we end this whole thing now? I'll settle for that. That's the plea deal I'm willing to take. And Job promoted death as this great equalizer. It doesn't matter if you're a king or a prisoner. In death, everyone gets to rest from their suffering. That is the picture that Job is painting. And he says that's especially true of those who suffer in this life in verses 17 through 19. He is just going down. He's just in a dark, dark place. And he describes people who want what he wants, who's in a similar place as him, as digging for death like it's buried treasure. And then they're ecstatic when they find a grave, which, go back and read that again, that's a bar. This dude's incredible. And then the section turns a corner. So he's been lamenting. He's been getting out his grief, processing through all of his stuff, just saying how he feels. And now he gets a little bit more pointed, a little bit more straightforward. So because of the narrator, we know that in verse 23, look at verse 23 if you want, Job says that God has given light to him, which he wishes was darkness, and that comes from the God who has hedged him in. And here's what's happening. You remember in chapter 1, right? The adversary comes to God and says, hey, you've hedged him in. You have protection all around him. Nothing can get in. Job isn't privy to that information. He's on the flip side. And he's saying, yeah, God's hedged me in with my suffering, and I cannot get out. He's going through it. And let me see if I can find where I was. My fault. In verse 25, pick back up, he uses a Hebraism, if you will. He lets us see behind the curtain of his emotions. He tells us what he's experiencing. It's like we've heard how he's feeling, but now we see what it really is that's going on. He names something for us. And Job states that he's haunted, that what he was terrified of most, whatever that may have been, has come to pass. He says, the fear that I feared, right? Here it says, for the thing that I fear comes upon me. But it's a Hebrew way of expressing. The fear that I feared. It's emphatic. He's trying to make a real point right here. The fear that he feared got him Stranger Things, like the Demogorgon got Will in the Stranger Things pilot. An idea is echoed in the next chapter, in verse 5. Job is being asked about the response that he's having, saying, are you dismayed that this has happened to you? Which is another way of saying, are you terrified of what's come upon you? In short, Job has expressed, and his friends are affirming, that he is currently living his worst nightmare. The things that had happened to him before, one, he's still living in those hard days, but it's also coming in waves. It's come back to haunt him. And he lands the plane of his lament with that Genesis 1 tie-in, that he's filled with suffering, that he's emptied of rest. Job bared his soul. He exhaled his emotions, his frustrations, his grief about his hardest days. And how does he handle them? Well, he was insulated. His friends were there. And he got it out. He got his grief out. And what about you? Have you felt similarly to Job? And have you given yourself the space to name it and to be honest? Have you ever felt so overwhelmed by a loss? Maybe it's a death or maybe it's something else. That you believed that death would be better than the pain that you are experiencing. If so, if you've ever asked God why, you are in good company. Job is right there with you. And for others of us, you know, I said, societally, we're not very good at this. Maybe this is super uncomfortable for you. Or maybe there's something in you where your upbringing is like, nah, B, this is wrong. I was taught that you shouldn't bring this type of negative stuff to God. What you were taught is a cultural mechanism for how to cope with your negative emotions, not what the Bible says about how to handle your grief. And here, if that rubs you the wrong way, let me help you. I'm going to cheat a little. I'm going to use the end of the book early, okay? Not too much of it, though. I want us to feel the plot line a little bit. God never corrects Job for how he spoke. That's not what God does with Job. He never tells Job that he was in the wrong for what he said or how he said it. God actually celebrates Job. I'm getting ahead of myself. Dang, but I have to tell you that because I want you to be free. I want you to live the way of Jesus, especially when it's hard. Because that's where we experience healing. We say God is a healer. But if we don't allow ourselves to be hurt, if we stuff our wounds and don't let them out, if we don't get it out, then he cannot heal us. We're lying to ourselves and we're living lies. The adversaries pulled a fast one on us. I'll get more to that in just a second. This is an example of how to handle our historically hard days, when they're happening and when they come back around to haunt us. Does this sound familiar to you? Does this sound like what you practice? I'm not asking to shame you. This isn't about you doing something wrongly. I just want you to see that there's a better way if this isn't something that you are familiar with. Lament is one of God's greatest gifts to us because life is hard. And if we did not have the release valve of bringing all of our wounds, all of our tears, all of our brokenness to him, where would we be? It's one of the great differentiators in this book. Job brings his stuff to God. These other dudes, these friends, they don't. They don't have a view of God that's personal and relational. And maybe it's easy to relate to God on easy stuff because that's the culture that you come from. But I'm telling you, the culture of heaven has space. It holds space for your grief. God welcomes your lament. It's a means of trust. You are saying you trust him when you bring him your grief. And doing so while you're insulated is just another level of blessing, of gift from God, of grace. And your community can hold you down if you let them in. So as a challenge and a comfort, I want to quote a doctor whose kind of specialty is complicated grief. This is, like I said, a consolation and a bit of a challenge to let you know that there are negative ramifications for running from hard stuff, for refusing to get your grief out in some capacity. Dr. M. Catherine Scheer asserted, "Grief can overwhelm our usual emotion regulation capacity, forcing us to resort to escape and avoidance to get some respite." And she went on. She's cautioning against stuffing negative emotions about loss, specifically with bereavement in her article, but she kind of expounds it, it includes other things. So for those of us who have experienced how challenging it is to grieve well, which, again, raising it 99.4%, I'm sure, she offers this consolation, saying that it is part of our body's natural response to press in and then to back out, to press in and then to back out. She wrote, "A guy named John Bowlby observed that our minds naturally and mercifully." That is just like such a beautiful way of framing that. "Our minds naturally and mercifully oscillate or switch between confronting and avoiding the painful reality. But defensive exclusion, or, you know, continuing to run away from the hard, is inadequate in the long term. When used exclusively, avoidance hinders the learning process." Catch this part. "Moreover, running from it leaves the sufferer ever vulnerable to the sudden, unexpected occurrence of painful reminders of loss." Saying that when you are triggered by that grief, when it comes back to you and you continue to try to stuff it, you will just forever be in a cycle of medicating, of unhealthy coping habits. So you lie to yourself and tell yourself that you're fine or that you're over it or that you've been through this, and then you run from it. But the problem is, it's like a shadow with you, haunting you, and you're proving it with your negative patterns in response to your negative emotions. For some who struggle with any form of addiction, they say that addiction is an emotional disease because it starts with an emotion that's triggered, and your brain just follows the same neuron highways and pathways to get right back to the thing that will help you feel a release. And then you're addicted to that thing. Rather than being healed and coming up with healthy forms of regulation, you are bound. There's a better way. Jesus offers us a better way. With that in mind, because I feel like I've belabored the point, you get your grief out, right? And you cannot control how others respond. So let's move on and see how Job's friends respond. Third point is this: hold on to truth. Say insulate. Say get it out. Say hold on. Hold on to truth. When others respond to you in your grieving, hold on to truth. When you respond to others in their grieving, hold on to truth. Hold on to truth. Another way to say that could be, don't take bad counsel. Also, don't give bad counsel, maybe. Try your hardest. It's a tall order. Man, such a tall order. Anybody? It's hard. Receiving counsel from others, insight from others is difficult. Amen? All right. Now, let's be honest. It's hard to give. Okay, cool. All right. So we hold on to truth. When you respond to others while they're grieving, hold on to truth. And if that's a particular struggle for you, you can always just apply Proverbs 17:28. Jules, can you put that up on the screen? There it is. Even a fool who keeps silent is considered wise. In Jesus' name. Didn't you think Job's friends were great for three verses? Maybe you still think they're great. That's why we need to get into it. Well, Eliphaz, one of Job's friends, responds. And in his response, we learn everything that we need to know. To an extent, we're going to nuance, you know, his perspective throughout the book. Well, I guess Job, the writer, does. But we didn't read his response. It spans chapters 4 and 5. We're not going to read that. I mentioned it. But I want to hit the high points, and then you can go back and read it. But I'm telling you, I would almost bet a dollar a lot of dollars maybe, that there's something here that you maybe have never seen before that opens up the book of Job in such an incredible way. All right? Hold on to that. And if I owe you a dollar maybe. All right? Okay. So let's keep going. There are two things I want you to see. One is his view of God, and the other is an eerily familiar influence to his response. So we're going to start with his theology like we talked about 2 weeks ago. First thing that you see from Eliphaz is retributive theology, right? This idea that God, in simple terms, God rewards obedience or good deeds, and he punishes disobedience or bad deeds of some kind. That's the view that we saw from the adversary, remember? That's what he presents to God. That's what's being tested in the first chapter. And then the second chapter happens. Something similar comes out of Job's wife, right? Why are you holding on? Like, just die already, bro. Just give it up. So there's something happening here, and we see a similar thing here, right? So in the first 11 verses of chapter 4, Eliphaz encourages Job. Y'all ever received, like, a backhanded compliment? You know what I'm talking about? Where it's like, thanks, I think. I'm not really sure how to feel about that one. Well, Job's friend is affirming that he's been a wise and faithful counselor to others when they were buckling under the burden of their struggle, of their turmoil. And then he flips it on Job, and he's like, so Job, why aren't you taking your own medicine? Why aren't you practicing what you preach? Why aren't you living according to your own counsel? That's like, dang, don't do that, all right? And then in verse 7, he asks Job's, when or where were the upright ever cut off? Which is kind of a twofold statement. One, he's saying that he's accusing Job of having sinned. Like, you're obviously not upright. And the second thing is, he's assuming what God's up to and how God views Job. We know how God views Job. We know that his accusations are false. And then in chapter 5, Eliphaz insists that those members of God's divine council that we talked about, if you haven't gone to watch the Bible Project Spiritual Beings video series, it will be helpful in understanding what's going on there. But Eliphaz says, ain't nobody that sits around God's round table coming to hear anything that you're talking about, Job, because you're foolish. You're being foolish. And because of that, Eliphaz basically accuses Job of experiencing what we're about to read in verses 3 through 5 of chapter 5. See if this sounds familiar to what Job has experienced. Oh, I want to fight this guy for Job's sake. Violence isn't the answer, but I feel mad. I'm lamenting. I have seen the fool taking root, but suddenly I cursed his dwelling. His children are far from safety. They are crushed in the gate, and there is no one to deliver them. The hungry eat his harvest, and he takes it even out of thorns. And the thirsty pant after his wealth. Sounds eerily familiar to what Job has gone through. He's saying, fools experience this type of stuff, man. So what does that say about you, Job? Oof. Our friends say some hurtful stuff to us unintentionally too, huh? Or intentionally. It's okay. We forgive and move on. And grief. And then it comes back to haunt us. And that's why we need this passage. He contended that God is shutting down the wicked and restoring the righteous. And he urges Job to welcome God's discipline, which is the context for verses 17 and 18, in which he says, behold, blessed is the one whom God reproves. Therefore, despise not the discipline of the Almighty, for he wounds, but he binds up. He shatters, but his hands heal. And in his mind, if Job will just admit that God's correcting him for something that he's done wrongly, then he'll get all of his prosperity back. God will make it right. It's cool. He'll restore you. Just admit, bro, you're in sin. You deserve this. The problem with that is that issue is that Job wants to be exonerated. Job knows that he's innocent. We know the narrator has put us on. We also know that he's blameless. God even said so. We also know that God cares more about Job's authentic righteousness than he does about Job appeasing him and lying. That's not what God is after. Job knows that. And so a favorite to many, stranger to, I'm sure, very few, Dr. Tim Mackey, one of the founders of the Bible Project, promoted the thoughts of a Jewish scholar who proposed that the books exploring three claims made about God and Job. You can see it up there, maybe. But only two can be true at the same time, like a game of two truths and a lie. God is just and good, that God's character compels him to always act justly for the good of others. The retribution principle, God has ordered the world so that good deeds are rewarded and evil deeds are punished. And Job's innocence. Job has done nothing to deserve his suffering. So readers have to pick two. You can pick one and three and side with Job, that God is good and Job is innocent, so there's some sort of a discrepancy that's unfamiliar, obviously. Or one and two, and you side with everyone else. As a reader, that's the tension that you are to be experiencing as you read through. Is something going to come out that I didn't know about? I don't think so. I think I want to side with Job. There's another Stranger Things reference here, but I'm not going to say it. This is the narrative arc of the book. So it's interesting, right? This is so, so interesting. The adversary, Job's wife, and now Job's friends are all agreeing that the world functions on what we're to be seeing as a faulty view of God. So what's happening here? It would be natural for you to be like, that's what Theo does now. He'll be thinking, he'll go, it's the best. Happy Father's Day to me. It would be natural for you to wonder, why is everybody in agreement? That's strange. We got the narrator gave us a couple peeks behind the heavenly curtain. Can we also have that here? Let's look at the influence, all right? So look, this is crucial. Oh, man, this is what I was mentioning. This is so pivotal for getting this book. And it has an impact on you as well. In chapter 4, I skipped over it on purpose. Verses 12 down to 21, the end of the chapter. Eliphaz announces a very interesting source for his perspective. Ooh, let's go. All right, we're going to read a couple verses here. I'm going to start in verse 12. I'm going to read down to 16. He says, "Now a word was brought to me stealthily," say stealthily. "My ear received the whisper of it," say whisper. "Amid thoughts from visions of the night, when deep sleep falls on men, dread came upon me and trembling, which made all my bones shake. A spirit glided past my face, and the hair of my flesh stood up. It stood still, but I could not discern its appearance. A form was before my eyes. There was silence. Then I heard a voice." Anybody want to keep reading? Like, oh my God, what did it say? It's good writing, man. I'm telling you, this book is crazy. So, we've been talking about things haunting. This is pretty spooky. Can you agree? Part of that's I read it that way, so it's my fault. But it is spooky. Eliphaz is the first of the friends to speak. That's important. He says this, which is important. He's maintaining that a spirit has swayed his outlook. And this messenger comes stealthily. It's a word that connotes stealing or entering secretly. Basically, B&E in a word, okay? It also whispers, which is a way that God, it's been revealed that God reveals himself in a whisper, right? A still, small voice. That's a way. But in this book, I'm cheating a little bit, God doesn't whisper. Not in this book, okay? And then here's another kicker. Whoever this is, there's no announcement not to fear, and there's no association with Yahweh. There is no word of the Lord, thus saith the Lord. It's just a word, just a little message from an anonymous messenger. Last piece. This spirit's message doesn't align very well with God's character. I mean, look, in verse 18 it says something to the effect that he has little interest in the beings that he's created in heaven. And it goes on to say that he cares less about those who are on earth. One commentator said, to a God so transcendent, the death of a sinful man is of little consequence. God doesn't care about your suffering. That's what this messenger is, you know, leading on in speaking with Eliphaz, which also doesn't fit with what Jesus says later when Jesus was here, and I think it's Matthew 10, when he's talking about how God knows when every sparrow falls, and that's in a context when he's talking about how much more God cares about people than these little bitty birds. If I could sing, if I could sing, Akila, Miss Terry, do you want the mic? Come on now, let's do it. We'll get there. So what is happening here? Remember, the narrator provided a peek behind the heavenly curtain in chapter 1, did the same in chapter 2. Here's the closest thing that you're going to get to a peek behind the heavenly curtain, if you will, here. The narrator doesn't cut in, but the author gives us everything that we need to trace the source of Job's friends' counsel. Remember, the adversary came for Job over and over. He even came through people like Waldo showed us last week. Bone of my bone, flesh of my flesh, right? That's Genesis chapter 2. And then here, the adversary is like, skin for skin, I'm going to touch his bone and his flesh. Huh? Yes, he gets the boils, but he also comes through the attack with his wife. And once again, here we have this. So I mentioned the structure and the storyline of Job. Again, in chapter 1, there's a test. And in verse 22, that concluding statement says, in all this, Job did not sin or charge God with wrong. Same thing in chapter 2. There's a concluding statement. In all this, Job didn't sin with his lips. Here we are again. Job is being opposed by his friends. There's this third test, and the adversary is coming once again. That's the structure of the book of Job. There is a test at hand, and Job is, he's got to be either faithful or he falters. That's what's on the table. So as a reader, you're thinking, man, what's Job going to do? And you have this panel, and another panel, and another panel, these speech panels, right? You have a friend, and then Job responds. A friend, and then Job responds. A friend, and then Job responds. And that happens three times. And that's a test. Will Job stick to his guns, trusting that God is good, and not lying about the fact that he hasn't done anything to bring about his suffering? Or will he cave to retributive theology? Will he believe a lie about God just so he can get the blessings of God back? That is the plot. That is the storyline. That is what's happening with Job. Will he choose to live lies as opposed to living out of truth? And we are tempted in very similar ways, are we not? That's why we need to hold on to truth in the same way that Job is holding on to truth in the midst of this accusation. We need to hold on to truth because the adversary tells us lies too, right? That are especially haunting because he'll give us just enough truth to make it sound close enough to right. Won't he? Helping us rationalize. Helping us consider it. And oftentimes, what's said about us or what's said about God is just true enough. It's just disproportionate. It isn't as true. Or it isn't as true in the way that God presents it. Man, sometimes other people in our lives can participate. They may not say the same things that Job says, but maybe they just are participating in stunting our grieving process. Maybe well-intentioned people say things to us like, stay strong, stunting a grieving process. Time heals all things. I am here to tell you, time is time. Time is distance. It's a space, not a healer. Time is necessary and helpful, but it does not heal. God is good, so you shouldn't feel all that bad. What good is being mad going to do about it? the adversary, can utilize these things and get us to repress or refer our pain until we've slowly begun living lives about ourselves or about God. You see, the enemy of our souls, he doesn't just tempt us to lie or to hate or to ignore our roommates or to withhold from our spouses or to lust after other people's things or other people's bodies. He also wants to twist your emotions, to prey on your wounds, to get them to fester and to use them to warp your theology. So if you're book clubbing with your huddle this summer, our hope for studying Live No Lies together is that you would live the way of Jesus and be free and be healed. All of us know that the adversary wants to feed us dissenting voices, deceiving influences, devious lies. And we need to hold on to truth about God and about ourselves for ourselves, right? We also want to hold on to truth for others. As siblings, when the hard days come, when they're happening, or when they are haunting those that we love, are we holding on to truth and helping our brothers or our sisters by directing them to God in an accurate way? Sometimes when people share with you, you don't need to speak at all. Another way that I think about this, with it being Father's Day especially, is training our kids to express and regulate their emotions. Parents, before your kids can learn a proper theology about God, you can lay a foundation for them practicing this passage. Job was honest with God. He told him everything. He brought his tears. He brought his doubts. Are you teaching your children to name their emotions? To express them? To get it out? Are you practicing likeness to God by hearing their hurts? By hearing their frustrations? Or are you more likely to pacify their pain with invalidation or with entertainment? Redirecting is a helpful practice in parenting. It cannot be the only practice. Are you helping them to engage or to avoid? Remember, our brains naturally do both. So as parents, we can do both. But we must be doing both. And as we empower our kids to come vulnerably to us with their emotions, no matter what they are, we can teach them about our King a little bit at a time, who does the same. Laying a foundation for them to hold on to truth as they get out their grief. Parents in the room, does that sound like a vision that you want for your own life and for your kids? It sounds appealing to me, and I'm so grateful for this passage that pushes me toward it. And I have done my best today to spare you the Stranger Thing. The hardest thing that I've done today is not talk about Stranger Things. But hopefully, As you go back and watch Stranger Things, if you choose to do so, hopefully this sermon actually brightens it up for you in some specific ways. That would be a gift to me. But if you haven't seen it or read it, you've had 36 years to do so. Almost. The kids band together, they face their fear, they fight it. Because it's not a clown, it's just its primary form. It's fine. Read it later. And they choose to go back to Derry 27 years later. They choose as a team, insulated together, to be known by one another and to run into their fears. Not to be isolated, but to be insulated. And they face it and they win. They win for themselves. They win for each other. And they win for everyone else that that haunting monster could have impacted. They didn't hide from the hard days in their past. When it came back to haunt them, they ran into the dark, not from it. I want to encourage you to do the same. Simply, the way to do that, insulate, don't isolate. Get out your grief. Hold on to truth. At Disciple City, We have a time of contemplation. Most should be familiar with it, but we do have a few guests here. I just want to say what we do during contemplation is we just sit, or we stand, or we come to the front and pray, and we consider all that we've heard, all that we have sung, what God is doing in our lives personally. We ask a few questions. What is God calling us to start? What is God calling us to stop? What is God calling us to believe? And is there anyone that God's calling us to share this message with? So today, take a few moments, sit and contemplate. Our prayer team comes down to the front. You can come and pray with them. If you would like to come and lament, this is a safe space to do so. What was it, 6 years ago, Marcus? Back in Mercy Street, one of our anchoring memories is that we lamented together. We wept at that stage together. And I'll take that with me forever. And you can do the same if you need. Because life is hard, right? Insulate, get it out. Hold on to truth. Love you guys.
Stand and sing with us.
Worthy of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We'll live for you. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe, we live for you. Oh, we live for you. And holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder. Song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. There is no one like you.
beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder and show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me. And holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside.
Time, take it. You don't have to rush out of here. AC stays on by itself for like a couple more hours. And if you got kids, you need to go grab them, but they can run around in here too. That would be fine. If you need time, if you need to grab a sibling, if you just need to contemplate more, take it. If not, if you're on your way out, dads, once again, there is a seasoning for you in the back, courtesy of our garden and our creation care ministry. Claire and the team, thank you so much. I cannot wait to experiment with that. Pray for me on that one. I'm going to ask Jamal how he does. I have a feeling, you know, I have a sense. But then also, women's ministry, there's an event this Saturday where the women's ministry will be serving together in the fellowship hall, putting together these welcome home baskets for those who are currently houseless and going through a program to be relocated, job training, and those sorts of things. If you want to hear more about that, you can register for the event. There's a way to communicate through that. You can talk with Sierra. She's not here today. But I'll have to say, if you want to be a part of this, you can do two things. You can purchase some of the supplies that are needed. You can find that through our website. Go to events, find this event. It'll tell you where to go. Or you can build the baskets, not just buy stuff for the baskets, but you can build those baskets, create them. Sierra and the team, they have a goal of creating 40 welcome home baskets. So ladies, you can come and kick back with other women like yourself, all types of women from all different walks of life, different life stages, and build those welcome home baskets. If you're a member here, just want to ask you to consider giving, still continuing in the mission, partnering with people like the Stew Pot. Also, you can find that on our Connect Center app, Church Center app. You can, if you're a guest, don't worry about the giving piece. Just go back there to the Connect Center. We got people who want to welcome you, say thanks for being here, give you any information that you might be looking for right back there at the table. So, guys, thanks for being here. Hopefully you get to take a nap. You know, engage and then avoid, right? That healthy oscillation, mercifully, because it was heavy today, yeah? But I pray it's a blessing to you so that we can be great together. May the love of God and the sweet communion of His Holy Spirit go with His people now and forevermore. Let all God's people say, go hug the Crawfords, go hug somebody that don't look like you. If you're not hugging, go dab somebody, go air five them, all those sorts of things. Love you guys.
Faith to fade, I'm moving on, I'm moving on, I'm moving on. I'm getting older, so I'll keep it straight. It hurts to let go, but it hurts more to stay. I'm moving on.